to grab a bit of the context here. 1 Kings 18, beginning of verse 17, this is God's holy word. When Ahab saw Elijah, Ahab said to him, "Is this you, you troubler of Israel?" He said, "I have not troubled Israel, but you and your father's house have, because you have forsaken the commandments of the Lord and you have followed the Baals. Now then, send and gather to me all Israel at Mount Carmel, together with 450 prophets of Baal and 400 prophets of the Asherah who eat at Jezebel's table." So Ahab sent a message among the sons of Israel and brought the prophets together at Mount Carmel. Elijah came near to all the people and said, "How long will you hesitate between two opinions? If the Lord is God, follow him. But if Baal, follow him." But the people did not answer him a word. Then Elijah said to the people, "I alone am left left a prophet of the Lord, but Baal's prophets are 450 men. Now let them give us two oxen, and let them choose one ox for themselves and cut it up and place it on the wood, but put no fire under it. And I will prepare the other ox and lay it on the wood, and I will not put a fire under it. Then you call on the name of your God, and I will call on the name of the Lord. And the God who answers by fire, he is God." And the people said, "That is a good idea." Reading of the word of the Lord. Be seated and let's pray together. Lord, your word is a lamp to our feet and a light to our path. We pray then that you would open our eyes to behold wonderful things from your word. Enlighten that path. Enlighten your word by the ministry of the Holy Spirit in our hearts. Empower the preaching of your word. Empower the hearing of your word by that same Spirit who indwells every believer. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
We've been working our way through 1 Kings 18, the centerpiece of which is this great showdown, this great confrontation between Elijah and the prophets of Baal on Mount Carmel. And the approach we've been taking is to follow the narrator's division of the chapter into sections by the pairing together of the main characters of this narrative, which form a series of seven vignettes. Next Lord's Day, Lord willing, we will finally come to this showdown, this confrontation between the prophets of Baal and the Lord's true prophet, Elijah. And that's the 25 through 40, that's the sixth vignette. And then Elijah and Ahab, part two, is in verses 41 to 46. The postlude to the showdown forms the seventh vignette. We considered the first three, these first three pairings in verses 1 to 16, which we call the preparation or the prelude to the showdown, Jehovah and Elijah, Obadiah and Ahab, Elijah and Obadiah. And then last week we considered the fourth pairing in verses 17 to 20, Elijah and Ahab, which we labeled the proposal for the showdown. Tonight we're looking at the fifth pairing, Elijah and the people, the purpose of the Mount Carmel showdown. And here we learn that the true and living God, that Jehovah, demands our unwavering fidelity and is worthy of our absolute confidence. Jehovah demands our unwavering fidelity and is worthy of our absolute confidence. Elijah's twofold purpose for the Mount Carmel showdown is first to demand that God's people choose between Jehovah and Baal, and secondly, to demonstrate that Jehovah, not Baal, is the true God. To demand that God's people choose between Jehovah and Baal, to demonstrate that Jehovah, not Baal, is the true God. So then in the first place, what is Elijah's purpose here? What is the Lord leading Elijah to do in this great confrontation, which is to take place on Mount Carmel? His purpose is to demand that God's people, Israel, choose between Jehovah and Baal. Elijah's address to the people in verse 21, expressing his first purpose, actually has two parts. First, to expose Israel's wavering fidelity to Jehovah, and then to demand this choice. Choose whom you will serve. If Jehovah is God, serve him. If Baal is God, serve him. This mountaintop action begins with the opening words of verse 21. Elijah came near to all the people. This was the first movement, we could say, on the drama that takes place on Mount Carmel. Elijah, the man of God. Elijah, the man who stands before Jehovah, the God of Israel. Chapter 17 and verse 1, chapter 18 and verse 15. Elijah, who speaks the true word of Jehovah. Chapter 17, verse 24. Came near to all the people. Before this day is out, Elijah will say to the people, come near to me. Elijah is said to come near again when he calls upon Jehovah in chapter 18 and verse 36. This account will be about coming near. In this first instance, Elijah's purpose in coming near to the people is to expose their vacillating loyalty to Jehovah by the sharply focused words that he speaks to them in verse 21. How long will you go limping? One of our English translations reads. How long will you go limping between two different opinions? If the Lord is God, follow him, but if Baal, follow him. Exact meaning of this metaphor, to go limping between two opinions, is uncertain. The variance in the English translations, in our English versions, to waver, to falter, to hesitate, or to go limping between two opinions is indicative of that uncertainty. But its rhetorical impact is clear enough. The message is clear enough, isn't it? They are going back and forth. They are vacillating. They're wavering. They're halting between two different opinions. And whatever the exact metaphor may be, the two opinions are clearly identified. They are Jehovah on the one hand and Baal on the other. In their corrupted thinking, the people of the northern kingdom, the people of Israel, imagined that they could serve both the Lord and Baal. Such behavior sent the northern kingdom into exile to Syria. In 2 Kings chapter 17, verse 33, tells us that this is what they did when they were in exile. They hadn't even learned their lesson then. They feared the Lord their God and served their own gods, according to the custom of the nations from among whom they had been carried into exile. In the multicultural world of Ahab's northern kingdom, it wasn't a matter of either or, but both and. They welcomed the false religion of Queen Jezebel, and they gave it a respected place along what they imagined was still the true worship of Jehovah. A polytheistic outlook embraced inclusiveness. Indeed, this kind of inclusiveness requires a polytheistic outlook. And the situation in the Northern Kingdom wasn't so different from the opinion of today's world that lumps all religions together and assumes that all religions are acceptable and good for society. The either-or question that Elijah poses to the people of Israel excludes the outlook that they had embraced and that our world has embraced. Why not have Muslim, Mormon, and Wiccan chaplains along with Christian chaplains in our armed services? Why not approve the Islamic call to worship over loudspeakers along with church bells ringing, as the city of Minneapolis recently did? Can't there be room in a multicultural, polytheistic, tolerant, easygoing world for Jehovah and Baal? As it turns out, no, there can't. The one who actually is the true God demands your wholehearted, undivided, complete allegiance. And if he didn't, he wouldn't be God. If the Lord is God, follow him. But if Baal, follow him. The ultimate question, who is the true God, and therefore who should we follow, cannot be merely theoretical. Once you know who God is, you must honor him and give thanks to him and worship him and serve him. Otherwise, you're denying that he's the true God. Exchanging the truth of God for a lie, this is what Paul said, Romans 1, 21 and 25. So, faced with the spiritual confusion of his day, Elijah demanded that the people of Israel make up their minds. Joshua made the same demand after the death of Moses, when he said to the children of Israel, this was our meditation this evening, choose this day whom you will serve, whether the gods of your fathers, or the gods your fathers served, in the region beyond the river, or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you dwell. But as for me and my house, we will serve Jehovah. We will serve the Lord. And the same demand comes to every man, every woman, every child in every generation: how long will you go limping between two different opinions? I think that's actually the best translation. It's the most direct translation. At least it appears to me. If the Lord is God, then follow him. That's what we ought to do. We can't straddle the fence. You can't have one foot in the church and one foot in the world. The God of Elijah is exclusive. He allows no rivals. He says to his people, I am the Lord. That is my name. I will not give my glory to another, nor my praise to graven images. Isaiah 42, verse 8. To believe in God is to follow him with our whole being. If we're still on the fence, then we're not following God. And we may not even know God in a saving way at all. With God, it's all or nothing. He wants our whole heart, soul, and strength. Jesus said, no one can serve two masters. Matthew 6, 24. The Puritans put it this way. You cannot serve God by halves. In other words, the true and living God, Jehovah, is an exacting God who demands discipleship on the part of those who profess to believe in him. This is clear in Old Covenant Revelation. For example, in Deuteronomy 13, 4, you shall follow the Lord your God and fear him, and you shall keep his commandments, listen to his voice, serve him, and cling to him. It's nowhere clear in New Testament Revelation than it is in Christ's own words in Luke 9:23. If anyone wishes to come after me, let him deny himself daily and take up his cross and follow me. That's the demand. It's the demand to the people of Israel and Northern Kingdom who were hesitating between two opinions, who were limping between these two different views. And it's the same for us today. Israel's non-committal silence in verse 21 exposes their hesitancy to do what the true and living God demands. But the people did not answer a word. They weren't prepared to make a commitment to Jehovah exclusively. They weren't prepared to do what Elijah demanded that they must do. They were unwilling to make the choice that he put before him. It was so much easier to maintain the status quo as it was, as it had become in the Northern Kingdom, to put Jehovah and Baal together and call it all religion, and to believe whatever form it took was essentially good for the kingdom. No answer from the people introduces another thread in the remaining portion of chapter 18. It's an account about who does and who does not answer. The people begin, as we will see, like Baal in the midst of this showdown between the prophets of Baal and Elijah. No answer, verses 26, 29. Elijah refuses to accept Israel's non-answer. He breaks the silence in verses 22 to 24. He reveals his second purpose, the second purpose of the Mount Carmel showdown, namely to demonstrate that Jehovah, not Baal, is the true God. And the second purpose really has two parts as well. The first is to disprove the false God and then to prove the true God. The refutation of Baal before the demonstration of the true God of Israel. And so Elijah began setting down the rules, if you will, of this contest between God's true prophet and the prophets of Baal. And he does so with a display of good sportsmanship in which he gave his opponents every advantage. Anyone familiar with sports knows about the home field or the home court advantage. Teams playing on their home field or their home court enjoy a thorough familiarity with that field or court, and they can count on a majority of the spectators in the stands being their fans, enabling them to feed off the energy of the home crowd. And on Mount Carmel, Baal had the home court advantage. Elijah had already extended the home court advantage to Baal when he gave the directive to Ahab to gather all Israel and the prophets of Baal and Asherah to Mount Carmel for this great showdown. And so already the prophets of Baal are on Baal's home turf. Additionally, Elijah was outnumbered. He says in verse 22, he said to the prophet, to the people rather, "I alone am left a prophet of Jehovah, but Baal's prophets are 450 men. If there were bookmakers on Mount Carmel, they would be giving 450-1 odds against Elijah. Furthermore, Elijah offered the prophets of Baal a first choice of the bulls in verse 23, just in case one bull happened to prove to be more preferable than another for sacrificing. He lets his opponents choose first, something like allowing the opposing football team to decide whether to receive or where to kick off without a coin toss. Besides all this, he let the prophets of Baal go first, verse 24 and 25 says, a bit like allowing another team to take the ball in first in a game of half-court basketball. Remember, whoever succeeds first wins. This is like a sudden death in a sporting event. The first one to score wins. Whoever succeeded in bringing down fire just once on Mount Carmel would win the contest immediately. Elijah says, verse 24, the God who answers by fire, he is God. So if Baal had answered with fire, Elijah would have never gotten the chance to offer his bull, to call on the name of the Lord. He would have been a dead man, just as the prophets of Baal were dead men after their failure and Elijah's success. And then notice, too, that this entire contest, this entire confrontation, this entire showdown played to Baal's supposed strengths as a deity of nature. Baal was the god of the sun, so warmth and heat were his areas of special expertise. Baal was the god of the storm, so fire was right up his alley, so to speak. Surely, the god of thunder could manage at least one lightning bolt to ignite the bull that the prophets of Baal had chosen. So the showdown has been proposed, and the purpose of the showdown has been revealed, and this time the people were not silent. That is well spoken, they said. That's a good idea. So we think about this account, it becomes clear that everything that Elijah did on Mount Carmel demonstrates his unconditional confidence in Jehovah. which is a good model for Christian confidence. And you would do well, and I would do well, to incorporate into your faith Elijah's confidence in Jehovah. Christians tend to be quite defensive, naturally, because they feel threatened by a culture that's hostile to biblical faith. So when they go out into the world, they tend to keep pretty quiet about that faith. By contrast, Elijah went up on Mount Carmel and confronted his culture. He wasn't afraid of the numbers that he was up against, those who opposed him. He wasn't intimidated by the strength of their arguments. Elijah goes out into broad daylight, and he gave his opponents every advantage and make the strongest case for their religious beliefs. And he wasn't afraid to do this because he knew ultimately that they would fail. He knew that Baal was nothing. He knew that Baal was not a god, that he was a false god in the imaginations of men, and that even if Baal had 450 prophets, 450 times zero is still zero. From the beginning, he knew that this was no contest, that any attempt to prove Baal would actually end up destroying Baal's credibility, which had already been destroyed, because he couldn't bring rain in 3.5 years. It's hard to find a better model of faith than Elijah, with his unwavering trust, his confidence in Jehovah. As we think about that confidence, as we think about God's true prophet, as we think about the question that he put before God's people Israel, how long will you continue to hesitate between two opinions? How long will you go on limping between two opinions, two different opinions, if Jehovah is God, follow him. If Baal is God, follow him. Make a decision. Choose one or the other. And as we think about Israel's the question and the demand that Israel is faced with, we ought to be asking ourselves, am I in some way, shape, or form limping between two opinions? Am I hesitating between two different opinions? Am I sitting on the fence? Have I given my whole self to God? Or have I convinced myself that fidelity to Jehovah really isn't an either-or proposition, but rather a both-and proposition? Do you foolishly believe that the love of the world is compatible with the love of the Father? Am I trying to live with one foot in the world, with its lust of the flesh, lust of the eyes, and boastful pride of life, which are not from the Father, and with one foot in the church? The Lord is God. If Jehovah is God, then we're to follow him with both feet. It's what Elijah is saying. Making him first in worship, first in work, first in leisure, first in the life of the home. Here's one simple way to gauge whether we're limping between two different opinions. Unlike the waverer, the true believer is not silent when confronted with the either-or proposition. When the waverer is asked about spiritual things, he or she isn't quite sure what to say, is hesitant sometimes to say anything at all, like the Israelites on Mount Carmel. But when the Christian is asked about spiritual things, there's no reticence. He or she is ready and able to give a testimony concerning their faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. That differentiates the follower of Jehovah and the follower of Baal. To put it in Peter's word in 1 Peter 3:15. But sanctify Christ as Lord in your hearts, always being ready to make a defense to everyone who asks you to give an account for the hope that is in you, yet with gentleness and reverence. Let's pray. Father, we know that in some sense in our lives that we are waverers when it comes right down to it, that we tend to waver in our fidelity to you and our commitment to you. We simply pray tonight that it would not be so in us. We pray, O Lord, that by your grace you would help us to give our whole selves to you, our entire being to you, that we would be willing to sacrifice self on the altar of heaven and swear allegiance to you, Jehovah, the true God of heaven. O Lord, we pray that you would give us confidence. Confidence is something that we naturally lack because of the weakness of our faith, because we believe, but our belief is riddled with doubt, and so we ask, O Lord, that you would increase our faith. Increase our confidence in you, O Jehovah, the true God of heaven and earth, that you'd enable us to be faithful in serving you and testifying to your name in the midst of a wicked and perverse generation, in a world that is going to hell in a handbasket. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Let's stand.